Zoro is the generic, cool, badass fighter of the Straw Hat Crew. Or at least, that's the one-dimensional archetype that people often incorrectly pigeonhole him into. In my opinion, Zoro actually has an argument for the best written character in One Piece, though sometimes it can be difficult to discuss this or even feel like it's worth discussing when his obsessive fanbase seems so bent on pushing him as this one-dimensional caricature of an unstoppable sword god. I think it becomes so easy to overlook what a uniquely designed character he actually is. A rare combination of certain extreme characteristics that you don't often see in fiction. A combination that makes for a character truly unlike any other. So before we get into it, make sure to subscribe for more analysis videos like this in the future. So first let's talk about Zoro, the man who wants to become the world's strongest swordsman. Obviously it's nothing strange for a character to have a dream or a final goal that they are working towards, especially in a series like One Piece where so many characters are driven by their dreams. But even in One Piece, and even among the Straw Hats, Zoro's ambition stands out in a few ways. First of all, just the fact that his dream is inherently competitive. He's not looking to draw a map of the world, to become a brave warrior, to cure all diseases, etc., etc. His goal is simply to become the absolute best at what he does. He wants to be the number one swordsman. He wants to stand above all other swordsmen, to the point that even the heavens know his greatness. Zoro's dream alone makes him an almost inherently captivating character, as he carries such a grand, individualistic ambition. It's not based off a personal passion like cartography or cooking. It's not a desire to help others by curing diseases. Rather, it is a pure individualistic drive to surpass every single other swordsman in the world. The only other Straw Hat with a somewhat similarly competitive dream is Luffy, in that becoming the King of the Pirates inherently means surpassing all other would-be kings to become the greatest. However, a key difference is that I feel that for Luffy, it has been implied that becoming Pirate King is more so a means to an end. What Luffy truly wants is to become the freest man on the sea. That is what he views the Pirate King as, and an important distinction is the origin of how that dream came about for him. There's a lot we can infer from Luffy's backstory as to why he developed this goal. It seems like the allure of becoming Pirate King started with wanting to gain respect from Shanks, and was likely then given new meaning through his experiences with the Goa Kingdom, the Great Terminal, and Sabo's death, as this is where he began to understand the importance of freedom in this world, and resolved to become stronger in response. These childhood experiences seem to be what drove Luffy towards Pirate King, not necessarily an inherent desire from the start to compete and surpass all other pirates. I don't think the Luffy that first met Shanks already had this desire in mind. And so here Zoro stands apart further, not just in what his dream is, a grand, individualistic drive to become number one, but also in why he has that dream. A common misconception I see is that Zoro wants to become world number one because of his promise to Kuina. That's actually not true. The important detail that people often miss is that Zoro was dead set on becoming world number one even before the pact with Kuina was made. This is a crucial difference, in that it seems as though Zoro has always wanted to be number one, simply for the sake of being number one, which says a lot more about his character than if he was simply doing this for the sake of another all along. I think especially in the medium of manga and anime, we get so used to this trope of characters wanting to achieve some goal for the sake of a friend, or to become the strongest to protect the people they love, or so that they will be acknowledged, or some other childhood backstory that sets their determination to become the best. And of course I'm not saying there's anything wrong with writing a formative experience that gives the basis for a character's motivation, but it is also extremely refreshing to read about a character like Zoro, who genuinely is driven to be number one, because that is simply who he is at his core. He is innately driven to be the best. The reality is that someone like Michael Jordan didn't have some tragic backstory that made him want to be number one and absolutely dominate his competition. That's just who he was, a man obsessed with becoming the best because he wouldn't accept anything less. That's how almost all actual competitors are outside of the manufactured world of manga cliches, which makes Zoro such a breath of fresh air, in that it really feels like we're reading the story of a man who has just always had a personal goal of being the best, and won't accept anything less, because that's who he is. That's not to say the death of Kuina wasn't important. It adds new weight to his dream. Now he has a binding reason that he can never let go of his dream, but it doesn't change the fact that he was always innately driven to be number one. It's the perfect way to add depth to Zoro's motivation without changing who the character is at his core. So just looking at what Zoro's dream is and why he has it, we can already see an interesting character concept beginning to emerge. But what really makes him feel like such a larger-than-life figure is how bad he wants it. Zoro's need to achieve his dream, and the lengths he will go to for it, are simply incomparable, and this can easily be demonstrated by his first defining scene in the story, the duel with Mihawk. I believe this is the first scene that truly showcases Zoro's unrivaled dedication to his dream. Up till he met Mihawk, Zoro believed he had a shot at the title of world's number one swordsman, and of course this scene was so powerful because we got to see a character with such high aspirations and confidence in himself realize first of all that not only is he not who he thought he was, but that he was not even close. The gap between him and his dream may as well be heaven and earth. And of course it speaks volumes about Zoro's character that despite this utterly soul-crushing failure, this experience that had him questioning his entire reason for existence, that even despite having his sense of self torn apart, that he is still somehow able to believe in himself and come back with an even stronger resolve that no matter what, he will ultimately be number one. But while this may be the iconic moment we all remember, really the far more defining moment for his character came before this, when Zoro is stabbed near the heart and refuses to step back. Zoro could easily step back from the dagger and live, but refuses to do so if it means stepping back from his dream in the slightest. In this moment, we are shown that this character represents a drive unlike any other, as the dialogue makes it explicitly clear. Zoro would literally rather die than not achieve his dream. Now think about that for a moment. This is not the same as merely risking your life for your dream. There are countless characters in One Piece and other stories who regularly put their lives on the line in pursuit of their dreams. But there is a huge difference between risking your life for your dream versus making it a zero-sum game, where it's the dream or death, and there's nothing in between. For Zoro, here he is literally saying that for him it's world number one or death. There's no in between. Either he is the world's strongest swordsman, or his life is meaningless and he may as well be dead. There is no other character in One Piece who has ever put their dream on the line in this manner. Even looking at Luffy, while he obviously is happy to put his life on the line in pursuit of Pirate King, I don't know if I can confidently say that Luffy would no longer consider life worth living if he could not be Pirate King. Basically, if someone else found the One Piece before Luffy, would he then simply discard his life and resign himself to death? I don't know if we can answer this question yet, but that is what we saw with Zoro. He would choose death over a life where he is not world number one. The reality is that there are very, very few characters in fiction in general who are written with this all or nothing mentality when it comes to dreams, often because it can be viewed as a dangerous mentality. But with Zoro, it is romanticized. This level of drive is put on a pedestal. It's almost a mythic level of ambition to literally view life as meaningless unless you can be the greatest. And we get to see over and over again how this mentality fuels Zoro and is at the center of his thoughts every time new obstacles come up. Everything is in the context of his life versus his dream. Every opponent is an opportunity to grow closer to his dream. Every hardship is a test of whether or not he is even worthy of his dream. If he fails and he dies, then all that means is he was not worthy of his dream. It's this black and white, extreme way he views his journey in life that reflects the strength of his spirit, and naturally makes him such an engaging character to follow. Even just the process of picking out a sword becomes a riveting scene, when the character we are watching treats it as an all-or-nothing test for himself. More than any other character in the series, it is through Zoro that Oda is presenting this image of what absolute drive and dedication to a dream looks like. It is, of course, an exaggerated, unrealistic depiction of an ideal, but it is still an ideal Oda is putting on a pedestal. It is still an ideal to strive for. So Zoro, a great character to follow, defined by an individualistic drive to surpass all others, to become so great that even heaven hears his name, a man who would choose death over anything less than his grand ambition. But what makes him a masterfully written character is when we discover that he actually places his captain's ambition even above his own. This was the moment that launched Zoro's greatness into another stratosphere. Not just for what he did, but because of what seemed to define him before this moment. There is no other Straw Hat who would have had more impact with the nothing happened moment than Zoro. Because there is no Straw Hat who has had nearly as much focus spent on their personal ambition as Zoro. The weight behind this action is so powerful because of the magnitude of what he is giving up. Yes, every crew member would give their life for Luffy, but the dialogue here is important in that it also reminds us that there was already something Zoro valued above his own life, which was his dream, and he is also willing to give that up for Luffy as well. And so this is where the complete character of Zoro seems to come together. For so long, his journey on the surface seemed to be about personal drive and perseverance in the pursuit of one's goals. But there was another secondary layer of development that was taking place before our eyes. The Zoro that first met Luffy truly only had one priority in life. His dream was all that mattered, it was what defined him. And Luffy better be ready to die if he got in the way of that. This man was a lone wolf, he was on his own journey, and he wasn't looking to join forces with anyone else. Of course, over time, bit by bit, we see Zoro evolve. There is no exact moment you can point to where Zoro has a change of heart and starts to value Luffy's dream above his own. We don't really know where the shift happened, rather we can feel the gradual change taking place arc by arc. He becomes the first crew member to believe that Luffy will become Pirate King. He is the first crew member to actually start treating Luffy as captain. Scenes like the bar incident in Mocktown silently showcase the growing loyalty he has developed towards his captain, and subsequent scenes throughout Enies Lobby showcase the high standard Zoro holds Luffy to as his captain. Throughout it all, we also see Zoro shift from a lone wolf to become a resolute pillar of the Straw Hat crew, taking the responsibility of leadership and guidance when Luffy is not there, to the point that by Thriller Bark, two things are clear: that Zoro has complete faith in Luffy, as well as a firm commitment to his own responsibilities as a member of the Straw Hat crew. As such, the Nothing Happened incident feels like the perfect culmination of Zoro's character growth throughout the story so far. Suddenly, this whole dimension to Zoro that had been subtly developing throughout the series becomes fully realized. There is something more that Oda wants to say through this character beyond the idea of personal drive and ambition. Suddenly, Zoro becomes a character with which Oda can communicate the meaning and importance of loyalty. Witnessing over hundreds of chapters how much Zoro's dream meant to him, seeing over and over again his drive that seemed almost inhuman, only to then realize that he's willing to place someone else's dream above all that, is simply a transcendent act, as we have been shown how much he is giving up for the man he follows. And of course, the actual trial Kuma puts Zoro through to prove his commitment to his captain is the most symbolic demonstration of loyalty imaginable. Literally, not figuratively, but literally taking all of the pain, the hardship, the suffering of his captain on top of his own, shouldering the burden for the both of them, even if it ripped his body apart. And most importantly, not only did he take it standing, he took it silently, never saying a word to anyone. And that is the most important point of this incident, that Zoro went through the most harrowing and painful test of his resolve possible, and didn't care if anyone acknowledged it, or even knew, because that is what loyalty actually is. The point of the incident is that true, genuine loyalty is doing something purely 100% for the sake of someone else, and not because you expect something in return, and that includes even thanks or recognition. To refuse recognition means that the act was genuinely only for the benefit of the other person. So Zoro would give up his life, give up his dream, and go to hell and back for the sake of his captain, without ever saying a word that would get him praise or acknowledgement, because that's what loyalty is. It's also important to note that this doesn't negate or contradict his devotion to his own dream. As Zoro says, if he can't even protect his captain's dream, then his own dream is worthless. Meaning this, too, is a test of his capability to be the greatest swordsman. The same way Zoro believes that if he were to lose a fight, then he doesn't have what it takes to be number one. The same way that Zoro believes that if he were to fall victim to bad luck, then he doesn't have what it takes to be number one. So too does Zoro believe that if he fails to protect his captain, then he doesn't have what it takes to be number one. Zoro is still all or nothing on his dream. This is simply another trial on that path. And once again, if it ends in death, then so be it. So in both regards, Zoro is an extreme depiction of ideals. If Oda wants to showcase drive and ambition personified, then you have Zoro, the man whose only two options are death or achieving his dream. And now, if Oda wants to showcase what the essence of loyalty is, again, we see Zoro, the man who gives everything he possibly can and more for his captain, while truly wanting nothing, not even the barest minimum acknowledgement of his sacrifice in return. Zoro is such an extreme character because that is the most effective way for Oda to communicate the true meaning of these ideals. This is what it means to have drive. Zoro gives everything for his dream and accepts nothing less. This is what it means to be loyal. Zoro would give everything to his captain and expect nothing in return. The fact that these two sides of Zoro can coexist, that he can somehow be both the epitome of absolute unyielding drive for personal achievement, and yet at the same time be the ultimate embodiment of self-sacrifice and unshakable loyalty for another, this unique combination of seemingly contradictory extremes instead mesh together to make for a strikingly compelling, one-of-a-kind fictional hero. And the best part is, I don't think the picture is complete yet. It would feel a little off if Zoro's character concept was essentially complete before the halfway mark of the series. I've talked about the two ways that Zoro is sort of the consummate depiction of certain ideals, but that's not to say Zoro as a character has no flaws and no room to grow. I'm not talking about gag flaws like poor sense of direction and occasional stupidity. I think you could argue pride and arrogance were some of his flaws, though Zoro is humbled frequently enough in the series that I don't think that this is a clear area of growth. Also, bonus points for Zoro showcasing the essence of loyalty further when he completely cast aside his pride to beg for help from the man he wants to someday defeat, essentially once again doing the unthinkable for the sake of Luffy, without Luffy ever knowing. To be honest, I think bowing to Mihawk and asking for help was probably a more painful experience for Zoro than the Thriller Bark incident, but I won't get into that. More importantly, it feels as though one of Zoro's actual flaws may be being too stubborn when it comes to getting help. He wants to do things his way and isn't looking for pity or assistance. Too often it seems he may put an undue burden on himself to handle things, even when that's not necessarily the right move in the moment. The fact that he puts so much responsibility on himself is often admirable, but at the same time often turns out to be problematic, as he sometimes ends up pushing himself beyond his limits and getting in trouble. Whereas Luffy probably has the greatest willpower in the series, the difference between Luffy and Zoro is that Luffy has always been very accepting of the fact that he needs a lot of help. Luffy has always been ready to trust others to do what he cannot. Luffy is always very understanding of exactly what he needs to do, and is prepared to let others do the rest. Whereas with Zoro, he may sometimes end up carrying a load that he didn't need to carry. I don't think this has been played up enough just yet to be talked about as a major flaw that Oda is writing in for the character that needs to be reconciled. So far, I wouldn't definitively call it anything more than a minor recurring issue. But it is interesting to note that this was arguably Odin's fatal flaw as well. Always doing things his own way, shouldering the burden, stoically handling it himself. Not to mention, a large part of what specifically makes Luffy such a good leader seems to be his trust in others to do what he cannot. Now that Zoro's Conqueror's Haki has been confirmed, I do think there is great potential for the growth of Zoro as a leader, possibly even tying that into his repeated trait of trying to take too much on himself. And maybe there will be a new Zoro video that needs to be made at the end of the Wano arc. But if you enjoyed this video, then definitely like, comment, and subscribe. And you can support me on Patreon for my extended thoughts on this and all future topics. Special thanks to patrons Emmanuel Vargas, Super Gomezification, Omar Gaskin, Young Prodigy, Adam Jin Rakai, Camp Raftel, Cooper Akers, Felix Tengue, God Complex, Justin Holland, Ned Gum, Neil Patel, Shadow Chip, Spike SP, Someone, Jared Cumley, Russell Yumbao, Xheng 187, Ace Goldie, Agam, Alejandro Magalenes, Alfred Lalfred, Amelite 2609, Andy Tamelli, Arturo Gomez, Ashra 777, Aslan Karamudan, Bartosz Sawada, Bean Bean, Behenort, Benjamin Vonstein, Bobby M, Braden Heeger, Brandon Williams, Buzz 7 Zillicum, Charlie Hustle, Chill Mickelson, Chimney, Chris Cresser, Krista Sellums, Conqueror of Muffins, Cool Ice, Danieru, Dark Eternal, Darth Pumpkins, Dice, Diego, Don Ron, Dopin, Ezra Tanis, Fari, Florian Verdari, Garrett Clark, Gia Studio, Harrison Otto, I Think the Fire Festival is Gonna Fail, Jacob Cal, Jacob Heller, Jeremy Sunpar, Joaquim Torneas, Joe Darway, Joey Zitka, John Runner Melting, Jonah Green, Jordan Hood, Juan Perret, Kara D7, Keyboard Cat, Korib Tababu, Kotoha, Lolly Lolly, Laura, Lun, Limbo, Lena, Louis Aguirre, Melanie G, Minaj, Mihatsuba, Michael Orr, Michelle Dreyer, Mr. Pike, Mo Musa, Mohammed Al-Mahari, Monk D, Moody, Mr. G, Multi 2 Terminator, Newt, Noah, One Magnus, Patron, Rayzy, Rain, Ravine, Raymond Vera Cruz, Ray Lopez, Rob Williams, Robert Janik, Rohan Chug, Rohanite, Ryan Garada, Sam Penn, Semicolon 3, Shadow 17, Siddharth Vadnarkar, Skoro Bhagatia, Sushil, Spirit Gun, Shrikar Govindarajula, Stanley, Starlight Studios, Sin 7H37IC, Tanner Murphy, The Boy 13th, The One Atop All, Thanks, Tom, Travis Murray, Tyler Crowley, Victor Chen, Vince T, Vinny, Virgil Hawkins, Wally Tamana, Wiase, Wisdom Minari, Zaos, Zach Omar, Zayada, Meruim, Mr. S, Fuktrong, Brad Matchell, Irul Enigma, Mon.BlueMe, Pablo Rodriguez, and Wist.